Thank you, and a very good morning. My topic, as all of us, is rebirth. Rebirth, which brings hope for the future. But I'm going to talk about birth. And believe me, I can tell you something about birth. As a gynecologist with 35 years of clinical work, I have done, supervised about 18,000 deliveries. 18,000 babies born into this world, and it's a great moment. It's really a moment of joy that you can help in the process where you can give a healthy, screaming, live baby to patients, parents who are anxiously waiting for that. So these are the great moments. But the delivery room has also its dark sides. And in the course of these 35 years, I also had, and I will never forget them, 72 girls and women who lost their lives, who died while they were pregnant, who died when they were trying to give life due to pregnancy and birth complications. Most of these tragedies took place in poor and middle-income countries, in poor resource settings. And most of these tragedies are preventable. Because women die of preventable causes, and I will go a little bit more in detail. This is one of the greatest places I had the honor to work in Pumwani Maternity Hospital in Nairobi, in Kenya, where we had up to 100 deliveries every day. Here you see the babies who are born within 1 hour. And it's a great place where we were able to show that indeed, with good policy, with commitment, that you are able, that there is a possibility to reduce maternal mortality. Because most of the deaths are preventable. Women die because of high blood pressure, because of infections, because of bleeding, all things that you can prevent with good care, good skilled attendance, drugs available, and so on. Unfortunately, for many women, this is not the case. I've also seen in the 72 there were also a number of girls who died because of the complications of abortion. Typically on Friday night, they go to find a solution because the stigma is too big, because they cannot keep the child, and they are looking for a solution in the back streets of the big cities. Invariably, you find them the Sunday afternoon, the Sunday evening, they are admitted in the hospital because of complications, serious complications, bleeding, infections, and they die. In the maternal deaths, and there are too many maternal deaths, it's still a silent tragedy with over 250,000 women dying every year in the world, 13% of them are due to unsafe abortions. Those pregnancies could be prevented. Those girls could still be alive if they had access to family planning, to contraception. 47,000 deaths every year due to unsafe abortion. 47,000 preventable deaths. One out of three could be avoided if all women had access to family planning contraceptives, something that is, for this part of the world, it's taken for granted, but in many parts of the world, it's not like that. The unmet need for contraception is huge. 222 million women in the world are looking to limit the number of children or to space the number of children, and they don't have access. They don't have access to contraception. Why? Many, many reasons. There is no choice. The supplies are supposed to be there, but they are just not there. There is no access. Even if there are clinics available, very often women have no access due to many, many reasons. They have fear, there are misconceptions about what the side effects of contraceptives, a lot of stories that because of malinformation, the quality of the healthcare services are often poor and not providing the service, the quality that we are looking for, and there are gender barriers. And the numbers are staggering. 220 million women. Of those, 162 million live in poor countries. 63 million unplanned, unintended pregnancies every year. 19 million abortions, unsafe abortions, most of them. 82,000 women dying. But contraception is not all about maternal death. It is also about improving life and well-being. It's about less worry about unplanned pregnancies. It's also about self-esteem, when women do have access to family planning, when they can choose, they can better plan their education, they can have more access to labor market, they can join economic processes. It's also about parental care. It's also about employment opportunities, about participation of women into the workforce. It's about better health, better nutrition, better education for the children that you want. And it's about fewer orphans. Contraception is also about higher productivity, smaller burden for the family, smaller burden for the community, because you have less children who are sick, less children who need care. It's about reduced public expenditure for social services, for health services, and others. Contraception is also about higher savings and investments. And I remember, Professor Karan Singh, he is an Indian philosopher, politician, professor at the university, a minister, who said in 1972, development will lead to contraceptives. If the economy is, if a society is developing, women will have access. The same philosopher said 20 years later, in 1994, he said, well, contraceptives will lead to development. It's a key factor to lead to better development of a society. But contraception is also a human right. It's a right of a society, a right of all people, couples, individuals, to choose freely the number, the spacing, and the timing of their children. It's a right to decide for yourself. It's a human right, and we should look at it as a human right. That implies also that users, that people, adolescent girls, married couples, also the vulnerable, those who are marginalized, those who have less access to the healthcare sector, all people should have access and free choice. Free choice means that at least there are enough methods available, such as female and male condoms, oral contraceptives, emergency contraceptives, long-acting methods such as injectables and implants and intrauterine devices, because not all methods are suited for everyone. So people should have good information, good counseling, and choice, free choice. I'm heading the Department of Reproductive Health at the WHO, the World Health Organization, where earlier this year we published a guideline ensuring human rights in the provision of contraceptive information and services. And this is actually a guideline for governments, for managers, for healthcare providers to help them to ensure the basic concepts of human rights, which are accessibility, availability, affordability, quality, but also non-discrimination, also non-coercion, also choice, free of fear, good information, and no force or no violence. These guidelines can help the world. But reproductive rights are human rights. If we really want to move the field forward, we have to work towards the way people are thinking about reproductive rights as a basic human right. And already in the 60s, there were civil rights and women rights activists and leaders who were pointing, who were saying family planning, contraception, it is really one of the methods, one of the key methods that can help to ensure the reproductive rights as human rights. As I said before, reproductive rights ensure the choice of couples, individuals, adolescents, everyone to have access to the contraceptive methods they need. But did we hear, how come if you're also convinced that contraceptives are good for your health, good for the individual, for the family, for the society, for the world, how come that it is not a priority in our national and international programs, in the global community? Well, as John Cleland from the London School rightfully said, we have now faced 18 years of a horrendous neglect in the field of family planning. Because of even the word family planning was out of fashion, because it was kind of connected with population control and forced population, forced procreation. So there was global silence until recently. And I think I'm here to talk about not only what is not done, but we are here for rebirth. And today, for the last, let's say, since the last years, there is indeed a hope for the future. There are a number of agents, a number of factors that are now announcing a change in paradigm, that are leading to a different thinking, a different view on rebirth in contraception and family planning. And I'm very proud to be here today as the chair of the Reproductive Health Supplies Coalition with the secretariat here in Belgium, in Brussels. It's the world's largest coalition, bringing 300 organizations together who are willing to join forces and to look at how can we bring the supplies to those who need them. How can we increase accessibility? How can we lower the costs? How can we bring together all the partners around the table, looking at supply chain issues, looking at market dynamics, look at lowering the cost? So we bring, this coalition brings together the brains of the world and the technical people who can work together and working very hard together. Coalition is this year celebrating the 10th anniversary, and it's really the largest network and with largest impact on supplying the commodities. Another major event 2 years ago was the Family Planning Summit. And indeed, in London in 2012, the UK government, together with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, brought together 150 leaders of developing countries, developed nations, industry, private sector, international community, the civil society, in a family planning summit, with calculating what does the world need to reduce the unmet needs by 2020. A huge amount of money has been promised, over $4 billion, to meet the needs of the, to reach these objectives. And the objectives are, by 2020, to reduce by half those who are in need, the women and the girls who need contraception, who need family planning. If these goals are met, then we will have 110 million fewer unintended pregnancies, 50 million fewer abortions, 220,000 fewer women dying, and 3 million fewer women, babies dying by 2020. But rebirth, this is really hope and promise, but rebirth takes years and efforts. We have seen gains, but also big losses. It takes time. Just imagine that it took 7 years to add a second 5B Millennium Development Goal. Number 5 is aiming at reducing maternal mortality. But it took 7 years to add 5B, access to universal reproductive health and to family planning. And now we can see, we start seeing the benefits, the gains. Rebirth takes time, but also continuous effort. And that is our task as the reproductive health community. We have to ensure that this topic remains on the agenda, because there are many other competing urgent priorities, competing for money, for time, for importance, for attention. But we have to do that, because we have to act before The shelves are empty. We cannot afford the empty hands, and if it is too late, the empty faces. We have to act now. And if there is one thought, one key issue that we should take along is that the ability to make the choice of if, when, and with whom to have children is not a luxury. It's not an added extra. The ability to make the choice of if, when, and with whom to have children is a basic human right. And for that right, we should continue to fight. This thought alone should fuel all the efforts and energy, and this will be the rebirth of access, the rebirth of choice, the rebirth of freedom for women and girls all over the world, because we have to invest in them. Women are not only half of the world, they also make the other half. Thank you.